Hello, everyone. Welcome to the 50th edition of New Directors, New Films, presented by the Museum of Modern Art and Film at Lincoln Center. My name is La Frances Hui. I am the festival's co-chair and also a film curator at MoMA. New Directors, New Films is supported by Film at Lincoln Center's New Wave membership program, and Film at MoMA is made possible by Chanel, with additional support provided by the Annual Film Fund. It is my pleasure to present the world premiere of Dark Red Forest by Jin Huaqing, who is also the film's cinematographer and editor. Thanks for joining us from Hangzhou, and interpreting for us is Vincent Chang. Daya, ni hao. Welcome to our festival. And can you begin by telling us about this monastery, where it is, who are the people who live there, and how you became interested in this place?
So this particular location is in a very remote valley in the western part of Sichuan, in the region called the Ganzi Tibetan Autonomous Prefecture. So the reason why I actually wanted to capture images from this particular community, it's almost by chance that I came across this particular community that I thought that right after I saw how they live in this particular valley, I told myself that I must make a film, make a documentary about this particular community. It's really hard to say for a director, it's really hard to say what precisely is the reason why I want to shoot and make a documentary about this particular community. I do think that it almost as if that I, as a director, is having an internal dialogue with myself, and that somehow compelled me to make a film about the people in front of me because of what I have experienced with my eyes.
Mm. 可能对一个因为我拍了已经十多年的纪录片，其实可能对于我来说，我会有自己的一个想要拍什么的东西，但是我觉得可能会有很多我会喜欢的选题，但是能够真的有缘分去遇上，然后再把它拍出来，应该是很少的。 因为对一个导演来说，他的创作的生命的这个阶段应该也不算很长，可能是20年、30年或者更多一些。所以我们用6年去拍摄这个，对我们来说确实是一个非常大的一个巧合。So
I do think that if you think about the past 10 years, the decades that I have been making documentary films, of course, as a director, there is this thread of different subject matters that I'm really interested in, that I want to pursue and make them into documentary films. But in order for me, out of those subject matters that I'm interested in, to be able to actually come across people like this, to come across a subject, to come across a location that I really feel compelled to make, it is something almost fated to do so. And I think that as a director, especially documentary filmmakers, your career probably last 20 years for us to spend 6 years out of those 20 years to make this film. That means that we are very much somehow all the planet aligned in such a way that for us to have this opportunity to make this into a reality.
We see the film that's documenting this place from 2017 on. Why would you have spent 6 years there?
我们去了好几次去那些调研，去等待那个拍摄被允许的那个时间的跨度。中间等了很久，对，当然更多的也是在自己在筹备那些资金啊，在基本上是在各种等待吧，而且我们一开始拍了很多素材都没有用上，一直在外围的拍摄。
So we actually visited this location many, many times. And at first, because of the research that we have to do, because of the permission that we need to obtain in order for us to shoot there, because of the funding that we need to raise in order for us to make this film, there's a long period of time that we are actually in a holding pattern just to make sure that we are able to make this film into make that into a reality. And I do think that other than the period of time that we're waiting for this to be made and to be shot, there are also a lot of footage that we have captured during the early years when we started the research project, the waiting for the permission. We have filmed certain footage sort of not in the center of what you have, what you will be seeing in the film, but more of the things surrounding area that we had the chance in the beginning years that we have the access to, but they were not included in this film.
You embedded yourself seamlessly in the daily life of this monastery. How did you gain permission to film there? And how did you make your presence so invisible? What was your crew like, and whether you needed like translation there?
因为我是在中国的东部长大，其实我们到那个地方是非常远的一个距离，但是更多的还是在语言上，更重要的是在，对，就是。 他们如何接受我们的拍摄，因为这是一个非常肃穆的一个庄严的一个地方。我们其实就是不停的，刚才你们在问我为什么一直都没有拍这么长的时间，到了2017年才开始拍，是因为我们要不停的在那边去很多次，对，因为他们无。 无法很快的能够接纳我们在这个地方的存在，对，当然对于我们来说更重要的还要再思考如何的拍摄它，对，这个时间我们考虑了很久，对。So
I grew up in the eastern part of China, and this particular location is in the western part of Sichuan. In terms of the distance, it's very, very far away for us to reach. But I do think that in terms of proximity, that is only the easy part of this film. The biggest challenge for us definitely is linguistic. How are we going to somehow be able to communicate with them and gain their trust? So I do think that especially in a location like this, this is such a sacred place for the community. And we, in order for us to gain their trust, it takes many, many trips for us. As you mentioned before, that the film started in 2017, but we were there, we had made multiple trips beforehand, just so that we can somehow embed ourselves in this particular community without being visible. And also it takes a long time for me to think it through in terms of how am I going to approach this film and what will be the spirit, and what will be the theme that I want to capture with this particular film. So that definitely takes a long time and many, many trips, even before where the film started in 2017.
我们其实团队在更长的时间都在思考怎么去拍摄这部影片。 对，到了现在为止，我们团队也好，我们个别看过的人来，就会问一些问题，说为什么里面没有人物？对，为什么不能选择一个主人公？对，为什么我们没有在讲，就是我们没有在讲他们的故事？对，其实说，对于我来说，其实拍摄他们的人物是非常困难的。 从一个最基本的来说，因为他们一两万人在那边，他们没有我们跟他的交流也非常困难。虽然我带了一些藏族的翻译机跟，然后他们因为没有手机，所以他们的穿着也是一样的。所以我们他们的居住区，我们男生几乎也是进不去的，非常难。所以从这点来讲，好像拍摄一个人物会找不到他。 就是说，当你在人群当中发现一个人，所以要跟他讲几句话，他人一走你就找不到他，非常难了。但对于我来说，最难就是没有选择拍摄人物的最重要的原因，就是我们考虑说，我们不应该去打扰他们的修行，因为如果说他要接受我们的拍摄，他们肯定会跟他原来的生活就不一样。 而且我认为能接受我们拍摄的人应该都是修行不是很认真的人，对，所以我就没有拍故事、拍人物，对。但是最根本的就是说，我觉得我应该也是说告诉自己，我不应该用这种方式去拍他们，对，因为回答你们刚才问我第一个问题，就是说我们为什么拍这个选题，其实。 就是说我就会问自己，到底是什么打动了我？对，就是为什么会这么快决定要拍这个东西？应该说是，我被他们整个场景这些场所感动，就是这样远远的看着他们，对，就是很保持很远的距离看着他们，在雪花漫天雪花的场景下。 对，在非常寒冷的这个山谷中，有时候就他跟堪布就是老师在对谈的时候，我就在边上听，看他们脸上的那个虔诚的笑容，虽然我听不懂他，但是对于我来说就很满足。对，在那个天葬台暴雨如注的天葬台下，我看到他躺在那个上面，我都觉得一切都是。 非常令我感动，对我觉得就应该是要这个方式来拍它就可以了，对 ，OK.
So, as I mentioned before, it took us a long time to think about how exactly we want to approach this particular project and how to capture this particular community. Some people ask me why didn't I actually select a few protagonists or a few subjects to follow them throughout. Their daily lives. And why is that I chose not to create some kind of narrative line or storyline for these main protagonists or main subject for the film? To me, I really think that for practical reasons, it's really hard to identify certain individuals that I can follow them consistently throughout my shoot because they all look alike. They all dress alike, and I don't speak the language, even though I do have interpreters with me. If I have a conversation with them, and if I want to follow them for the later part of the film, I might not even be able to identify which one is the one I actually had the conversation in the first place. So practically speaking, it is really difficult for me to chase down those individuals that I want to capture their daily life. And I also think that since this is such a sacred place, I don't want to impose myself into their very, very strict and also very dedicated time in terms of when they're on their retreat. I feel as if that if I do so, it will create unnecessary disruption for their own cultivation, for their own meditation, for their own retreat. And I also think that those people who agreed to be followed by the cameras probably aren't those ones that might not be the most dedicated practitioners or the most dedicated Buddhist nuns. And so I really think that in order for me to capture this group of people in the number of 10 or 20,000 altogether, it is something that is a way for me to really not only overcome the practical difficulties and challenges, including myself as a male director, there's certain access I was denied as a fact, simply because the fact that I am a male person and I won't be able to somehow freely follow these individual subjects that I, if I want to make them the focus of the film. So I do think that is something that we have thought about, how we're going to approach this and forsake this idea of having very limited subject matters and creating some type of narrative or storyline throughout. So for us, it is about how to capture this particular community the same way I saw them for the first time from afar, that they are living in this snowy mountain range in the valley, and you see how they just coexist with this particular harsh environment. And also, by the way, I watch the nuns talking to their lama in such a way that they have their very sincere smiles as they're interacting with them. Or when I saw for the first time in the rain of how the sky burial was carried out. And those are all the moments that I want to focus on more than focusing on certain or very limited subject matters to follow throughout the film. So that is what we come up with at this long period of thinking about how we're going to approach this. And that's what we decided on, that this is indeed the way that we want to approach this particular film.
You mentioned earlier that as someone who's from the eastern part of China, it wasn't exactly easy for you to go to this place to gain acceptance. I want to ask you, Tibetan regions are monitored by Chinese officials. Did you have to gain their approval? And were you actually free to film as long as the monastery allowed you to?
政府还是宽容的。 其实难度可能大的还是在于在寺庙的管理上，对，因为拍摄这样的影片，其实我最最担心的就是影响到他的修行，对，所以为什么一年一年在等待，就是主要还是让那些修行的那些觉悟能够接受我的影像机的存在，这个非常非常难，比如说百日闭关。 大家在影片一开始就会看到，其实百日闭关我也很艰难的决定，就是到底是很远很远的拍，还是要相对的近一些。其实我拍了总共拍了4年，对，只有拍到了这么几个镜头。其实他们一开始对我真的很反感，我也很苦恼这个问题，就到底是应该更近一些，让观众能够看到他们的。 大概是一个什么样子的，对，包括天葬也是如此。其实天葬有些人看了之后就会对我说：“你不应该展现这个东西。”但是我自己觉得不应该是这样子的，因为其实从我的镜头去看那些天葬的镜头，我的理解是不一样的。 对，因为我觉得一切对于我来说都很美好。对，所以说这个美好，是导演我心中的一种感受，就是说我们，就是很多人也在问我说，你为什么好像全篇都在仰望他们，似乎都在看到很爱他们。我说确实是因为我跟他们在一起生活，在看着他们的时候，我觉得很多东西都是被感染的。比如说，他们的我看到一些小孩子在考试的时候讲那些因果，很老的觉母在讲那些我无法控制所有的事情的那些，他们在讲到因果律，我觉得讲到了那些生死，我觉得从来都没有一个，那是一个我从来都没有抵达的一个世界，一个王国。对，所以我觉得对于我来说，内心是非常震撼不好意思。
So to me, I do think that the communication, the negotiation, the permission from the government and from the management committee of the temple or of the monastery, it's something that is not the biggest challenge for us as a crew, as a team. I think that they have been very, very flexible and very encouraging for us to gain access to this particular community. I think it is the monastery or the nunnery itself is the difficult part. How can we gain their trust so that they will not feel as if that we are imposing on their studying, on their meditation, on their retreat? And for example, for me, the worst thing I can do is to somehow interrupt those Tibetan nuns during their 100-day retreat. And it took us 4 years just to capture very few scenes or very few shots of what is actually going on during those 100-day retreat for these Tibetan nuns during that time. So for me, I really think that it took us a long while in order for us to gain their trust so that we'll be invisible. At first, they were really, really bothered by our presence. But slowly and surely, after a long period of time, they started to really make us invisible, so to speak, that they are not bothered as much and can really go on their daily life, daily meditation, and daily routine, including during those period of time that they are on this 100-day retreat in the coldest days of the year. So I think that the scene about the sky burial, when I shown this to my peers, and some of them will say that I shouldn't show them because this is something that is morbid, that is something that might be too dark and too graphic for your audience to watch and to enjoy. For me, I think that is something completely different through my own camera. What I saw is beauty. What I saw is purity. What I saw is this spirituality that I want to not only capture, but also share it with the viewing audience. And for me, it's because in my eyes, this is the perfect example of what beauty looks like, what spirituality looks like. And I really don't think that I need to somehow remove them from my film because some people might find this too morbid or too offensive to look at or to watch. And I also interacted with some peers and they said, why are you always have this admiration, the way you treat your subjects, this group of people, this group of Tibetan nuns? And I have to say that indeed, I admire them. I treat them with love and care because I'm really, really touched by the way they see the world, by the way they talk about, for example, the interactions between the old Tibetan nuns with the younger one when they are talking about these karmic debts, these the issues of life and death. This is such a world, spiritual world that I had never been to, and I was so shocked and so touched and so moved and so at awe by. And that's exactly the reason why I want to really capture those moments, because I was very, very much touched by this group of people.
More than an hour into the film, we begin to see Chinese propaganda slogans promoting ethnic unity, and they appear quite out of place in this place of worship. How do the people there feel about the presence of these slogans?
对于我想对于这些修行的人来说，尤其是堪布。 他会觉得修行的人，可能包括我们的普通人，一辈子都会遇到一些变故，对。但是我觉得在我心中，或许他们在他们眼里，人生应该就是如此，就是说。 修行，这种变故或许对他们来说是一场特殊的修行，或者说上了生动的一课，对，或许他们会更加明白了佛法的真谛吧，对，而对我们拍摄的人来说也会感。 感受到了我们的人生应该也是如此，对，在修行的道路上，在我们的人生就会发生各种这样的变化，这才是人生吧。啊，OK。So
I think that there's certain element of change in life is something not only for those devotees of or practitioners of the Buddhist religion, but also for us lay person. Is to think about that this is part of the nature of being alive, is you have unexpected changes that you will encounter. And then part of, especially for those devotees, they will see this as part of their training, part of their spirituality, part of trying to gain true meaning of Buddhism and to true meaning of interpretation of life. And it's almost like a live lesson that they want to somehow take it as an opportunity for them to really reflect on all those themes, all those principles, all those philosophies that they have been studying in their the Buddhist religion. So for me, I do think that as a lay person, I really also see this as just another consistent nature or consistent element in life, which is the element of change. And this is part of that I see that we all share in common, to know that life is with unexpected changes, and it is part of our task in life to see how we react to them. And I think for them is through this concept of religion, to trying to work, think about what these changes mean within the context of Buddhist religion. For us, for me as a director, is to think about how these changes mean to me personally, based on how I experience life and how philosophy that I adhere to and to face and also to deal with these changes in life that is so inevitable.
It is not really explained in the film why the nuns are gradually leaving the monastery. We see them removing the cabins, the little huts, We see them bidding farewell to their teachers. We hear them talk about not knowing the way back home because they simply have been gone for too long. Can you elaborate on the circumstances of their departure?
我们在拍前面的时候，是不会知道后面发生的事情，对。因为这个变故不在我的计划范围内，对，好像在我个人的创作的理解当中，或许没有这个内容的存在的，对，我所关心的其实还是，他们的修行的那个状态，就是他们在回到各自的家里的时候，他们是怎么坚持跟原来的一样哈，他的修行是如何坚持下去的？对，就是我们当初也不太有心理的准备，说有这样的事情发生。整个影片当中，其实也有很多事情是我们预料到的，而有些事情是没有预料到的。前面部分可能我们一直在预期他们会发生什么和我所需要的那些场景，所以我就一直在等待，比如说我在等待，我在等待暴风雪，我等了很久，对，我就希望有一个暴风雪在一个听经的场景当中，我会在等那个暴雨。暴雨下来那个天葬台才是我期待要的那个东西。但他们回到家里之后，我觉得也非常美好，真的，我觉得他们在一个回到家里的这种雪地当中，对，我觉得他们还是内心依然是非常非常坚定，和原来一样的，对，无论是人多的还是各自在各自的地方，在悬崖上，在一个山坡上，在我心中依然是非常美好的。
So I do think that as we're filming this particular location and this particular group of people, there are things that we just cannot expect. As I mentioned before, those unexpected changes, even though it's something that is constant in life, but we didn't foresee those things happened. So in the beginning, when we begin shooting this particular group of people, this particular subject, there are certain things that we just, we didn't consider that as part of the reason why we began shooting in the first place. For example, there are things that we do have quote unquote control of, which is that we can wait for certain things, certain weather to happen. So because I really want to capture those moments. We know that it's going to happen, but we don't know when. So it took us a long time to really capture the snowstorms covering this entire landscape where we shot our film. Similarly, the time that when I want to really capture for the sky bearer thing scene, I really want it to happen during a pouring rain and the rainstorm. So that is something that we waited for a long time in order for us to capture this and then show it with our audience. One more thing also is that I see it just as delightful and as beautiful to see how these devoted Tibetan nuns, not only they were so, so dedicated and so much immersed in that part of their spiritual training, that part of meditation that they engaged themselves in the monastery. But when they return home, you still see that they are, wherever they go, they are carrying that spirituality, that type of devotion to seek the truth in life and to continue to cultivate themselves with their spirituality, that is something I think is what I want to keep in for this film, and what I want to focus on is how they develop that sense of spirituality, not only in the monastery during that 100-day retreat, but also when they leave and left the monastery and return back home, they still continue to practice and to cultivate themselves. I was quite saddened by certain changes that we observed when we were shooting there, and how these changes changed the landscape of this particular location, and also changed the cultural practices for this group of people. For example, and later on we have seen tourists coming in, and in the peripheral areas of this particular location, you start to see certain shops being opened up, like milk tea shop or other commercial vendors that you can see them mushrooming. And to me, that is something that I feel saddened about, just because I think that somehow change the nature of this particular sacred place so important for this group of people. I'll give you another example of modernization, how it changed the cultural practice for a group of people like this. In the past, when they finished their meal with their traditional bowls, they can actually lick the bowl clean, and because it's designed in such a way that is conducive to that particular practice. But now the modern version of those bowls, that they no longer have the ability to actually lick the bowl clean the way that they used to. So I do think that things like this, these changes that you do observe, and it's something that I'm saddened by. And what brought me pleasure and happiness is to actually interact with those people, those Tibetan nuns, after they return home. I had the chance for the first time through the interpreter, I get to talk to them and converse with them. And during those conversations, that they finally share with me that I was there for so long, that had been trying to capture the life for so long, because in the past, the Lama in the monastery, they tend to be very strict, so that they didn't have the chance to interact with me or with my crew. But now, after they return home, they finally had the chance to talk to us through interpreters, and I am happy to learn and know that they are still practicing, they are still cultivating, they're still meditating, and they are continue the traditions even when they return home. They continue their spiritual practice when they return home. So that's something that I was and very much delighted by.
I do want to say something to the audience. There are news outlets that have reported that the government has ordered many of these nuns to leave. When you look at the film, you see a huge piece of land with lots of building structures, but at least half, if not even more than that, are gone today. And we are looking at the disappearance of a vibrant culture, a tradition that's important to the Tibetan people. I think that the nuns, they can find peace anywhere, but they certainly do not prefer to be away from the monastery where they had chosen to be their home. And I am saying this because I think that the audience should know, and it will be okay if the director would not want to comment on this. Mm-hmm. There was a very vibrant period from around year 2000 to early 2010s when filmmakers were making films documenting realities in China, dealing with some of them sensitive subjects such as urban development, justice system, environment, and modern Chinese history. We are seeing fewer and fewer of those, at least overseas. There seems to be a lot less room for independent documentary filmmakers in China today. How is it like for you, and how do you see the future?
是的，就是正如你所说的这样，也是我的感受，就是每个导演的选择吧。我觉得像王斌这些导演，他们在拍他们那个感兴趣所关注的那段历史，我觉得我就拍不了，因为我可能不太去了解的东西太少了，就是对那段历史。对，确实每个导演都有每个导演的选择，可能大家现在很多导演想的更多的是，要商业性，要怎样服务去大众的观众，啊，这是我的理解。现在这中国的导演，所以就会有美食的，旅游的，各种的这种纪录片大量的产生。对，这也是一个不争的事实吧，我觉得确实是。对，但是我们好像也没有到灰心的时候，觉得我们想拍还是可以拍，只不过是在商业的社会当中要坚持一部一部作者的纪录片，他要克服很多很多的问题，可能是来自于我找不到团队，对，我的设备要越来越贵等等的，这个成本越来越贵，然后我的观众在流失，对，因为你没有观众，哪怕是我们去上映，他也没有观众，他不是一个商业 一条链条是可以完成他的。对，可能这样的社会，我们的物质越来越高之后，人的血性就会越来越少。所以我为什么要去拍《绛红森林》？我觉得它确实是让我看到了不同的人和我们的价值观和我们的生存方式是完全不一样的。对，是。
I think it's undeniable truth, what you just described. It is something that is going on and it's happening right now in China. And I do think that it's about choices. Different directors, they make different choices. I think for directors such as Wang Bing to make films about the subject matters that he tried to capture is something that I cannot make. That decision, that choice is not, it's not the decision and the choice that I will make and I can make because I didn't have real deep understanding and of that particular part of history, of that particular transition happened during that time. And I do think that right now, there are choices being made by a lot of documentary directors is to think about the market. It's to think about how they can be commercial and they can somehow serve the masses. And because of that type of elements and factors, you do see an array of many, many food-related, travel-related documentaries being made by these directors. So for me, that's the reality, but at the same time that I personally also have a choice to not to discourage by this, and I can still make the films that I want to make even under these pressures of commercializations of the documentary films. I know what I want to do as a filmmaker. I want to make auteur documentaries, but it is getting harder and harder for me to continue this particular mission and vision of my own and a choice that I made for myself. For one, it's getting more and more difficult for me to find crew members who will work with me to make my films. It is getting more and more expensive with the equipment that I need to use in order for me to make the films I want to make. I am also losing audience within China because the fact that my film, a lot of them, they couldn't be shown in China, and therefore there's no way for me to cultivate the audience that I want to cultivate in China. And definitely along with the cost of equipment is the cost of making films is getting larger and larger. So the reason why I still insisted on making this film, Dark Red Forest, is because the fact that what I'm capturing with my film in terms of these people, these Tibetan nuns, their reflection and their explorations and the constant quest on this idea of why do we exist and their value system that they still, they are holding on to amidst all these challenges and amidst these difficulties. It's very much something that I want to not only capture, but also use it to encourage myself and also hopefully inspire audience to really think about what have gained and what have lost during this time of change.
这是从我个人来说，我是非常悲观的。对，虽然我们很多业内的人说，中国的这一类的纪录片，作者型的纪录片。 永远不会很热闹，但是永远不会死去。但是我个人感觉，中国有14亿的人口吧左右，我觉得就这么这个几个人在拍摄，然后观众也不知道在哪里。对，我觉得这个是非常令我感到，对，因为我觉得像王冰、赵亮和杜海滨这一类的导演。 我一直觉得在80后、90后当中不会再出现了，这是我个人的判断。对，我并不认为80后、90后以后的纪录片的价值，我们的这种血性、这种思考的深度能够超越他们。我不这么认为。 对，所以我没有像他们那么乐观，绝对没有。对，因为现在的年轻人他生存的环境，虽然每个年代都有每个年代的问题，所面临的一些问题，但是，我觉得总是有一种东西已经被断层掉了，就是已经失去了。我认为是这样。哼，对。
So to me, I have to also say that I am not very optimistic, or I can say I'm pessimistic about the future of documentary films in China, especially art tour documentary films in China, for the fact that even though some people encourage me and say that, well, yeah, you might not become very, very popular with art tour documentary films, but at the same time that you can still survive, even though you will not be popular. But I think that there's a problem for 1.3 billion people in China. There are only so few of us making art tour documentary films. And I do think that for directors like Wang Bing, like Zhao Liang, like Du Haibing, these are the directors, art tour directors, I don't think that we will be able to see more of like them. Among the directors who were born after 1980s or 1990s. And the reason for it is because I do think that this particular generation or directors who were born after 1980s and 90s, they tend to have very different values, very different passions, very different critical thinking ability to make those films made by directors, art tour directors like Wang Bing, Zhao Liang, and Du Haibing. So I do see that there is a generational gap within documentary, art tour documentary filmmaking. And so that is how I see the future of documentary filmmaking in China. I am not very optimistic about the future.
Well, I am also not very optimistic, and but we have to have hope. And I thank you for making this film because I think it is an important document and record of a life, a tradition that should be preserved, should have the room to live. And so thank you so much.
谢谢。
谢谢导演。